interesting turning pages in the breeze. We'll give it a go. From Isaiah 53, yet it was the Lord's will to crush him and cause him to suffer. And though the Lord makes his life a guilt offering, he will see his offspring and prolong his days. And the will of the Lord will prosper in his hand. After the suffering of his soul, he will see the light of life and be satisfied. By his knowledge, my righteous servant will justify many, and he will bear their iniquities. Therefore, I will give him a portion among the great, and he will divide the spoils with the strong, because he poured out his life unto death and was numbered with the transgressors. For he bore the sin of many and made intercession for the transgressors. Come, let us return to the Lord. He has torn us to pieces, but he will heal us. He has injured us, but will bind up our wounds. After 2 days, he will revive us. On the third day, he will restore us, that we may live in his presence. Therefore, my heart is glad, and my tongue rejoices. My body will also rest secure, because you will not abandon me to the grave, nor will you let your Holy One see decay. You have made known to me the path of life. You will fill me with joy in your presence, with eternal pleasures at your right hand. The Easter Gospel today is from Matthew chapter 28, verses 1 through 15. After the Sabbath, at dawn on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to look at the tomb. There was a violent earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven, and going to the tomb, rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothes were white as snow. The guards were so afraid of him that they shook and became like dead men. The angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here. He has risen, just as he said. Come and see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples. Tell them he has risen from the dead and is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him. Now I have told you." So the women hurried away from the tomb, afraid yet filled with joy, and ran to tell his disciples. Suddenly Jesus met them. "Greetings," he said. They came to him, clasped his feet, and worshipped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee. There they will see me." While the women were on their way, some of the guards went into the city and reported to the chief priests everything that had happened. When the chief priests had met with the elders and devised a plan, they gave the soldiers a large sum of money, telling them, "You are to say his disciples came during the night and stole him away while we were asleep. If this report gets to the governor, we will satisfy him and keep you out of trouble." So the soldiers took the money and did as they were instructed. And this story has been widely circulated among the Jews to this very day. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, bless the reading, the preaching, and the hearing of your word this day. Open our eyes to see and our ears to hear and our hearts to understand, that we might bear good fruit for you. In Jesus' name, amen. Today I'd like to talk about the earthquakes a little bit and about the servants, the soldiers that were involved in the Easter story. Whenever earthquakes happen in the Bible, God is doing something special. In Exodus 19, when God descended on Mount Sinai to give the Ten Commandments to Israel, there were earthquakes. There were earthquakes on Mount Sinai again when Elijah went there and the Lord commissioned him for future ministry. And there's an earthquake mentioned from King Uzziah's time. But Josephus says that was the Lord's response to the king entering into the holy place to offer incense, which only a priest was allowed to do. The Lord got his point across with that earthquake. There are hints in the scriptures also of other earthquakes as well during notable time periods, such as the conquest, the crossing of the Red Sea, and so forth. And then there were these two earthquakes, the earthquake at the time of Jesus' death and the earthquake at the time of his resurrection. Matthew is the only gospel writer who tells of these earthquakes. And Matthew is the only one who tells of the soldiers who guarded Christ's tomb. But both earthquakes and soldiers add their testimony that Jesus is the Lord and that he is risen from the dead. Matthew 27, immediately following Jesus' death, it says, "When Jesus cried out in a loud voice, he gave up his spirit. At that moment, the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth shook and the rocks split. The tombs broke open, and the bodies of many holy people who had died were raised to life. They came out of the tombs, and after Jesus' resurrection, they went into the holy city and appeared to many people. When the centurion and those with him who were guarding Jesus saw the earthquake and all that happened, they were terrified and exclaimed, 'Surely he was the Son of God.'" If you go to Jerusalem today in the Church of the Holy Sepulchre, which is built over the site of Calvary and the empty tomb, you can see a crack in the rock wall. And that crack is said to date to that earthquake at Jesus' crucifixion. This earthquake occurred at the very moment that Jesus died. Matthew says the earthquake, along with the darkness and some other signs, but that earthquake influenced the centurion, but not only him, but also the soldiers with him, to conclude that Jesus really was the Son of God. Was that earthquake mere coincidence? Was the darkness coincidence? And the way Jesus died, where he even forgave his murderers, for instance? All these things could not have been only coincidental. And then in Matthew 28:2, in today's gospel, the Bible had said, "There was a violent earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven, and going to the tomb, rolled back the stone and sat on it." This earthquake happened as Jesus was resurrected from the dead. There were soldiers guarding his tomb. They felt the earthquake. They saw the angel. They saw the angel dressed dazzling white, that one of the Gospels says like lightning and white as snow. And he removed the stone from the tomb's entrance. And the soldiers found the tomb was empty. Were all these things also coincidence? These events were not only earth-shaking in their scope, but the timing was so very precise. These soldiers, too, those soldiers guarding the tomb, became witnesses of the other half of that most important event in the history of the world, when Jesus died and rose again for our salvation. And then in Matthew 28:11, the Bible says, "Some of those soldiers went and reported these things to the chief priests." They told them everything that happened. As a result, the chief priests gave the soldiers a fake story to tell. A story really that's too ridiculous to even believe. So after Good Friday and after Easter then, some Roman soldiers became believers in the Lord Jesus. Well, how can I say that? How else would Matthew know what the soldiers were doing, what they saw, and what they did, unless some of them told him? And why would the soldiers even talk to Matthew unless they became part of the group? Of course, Acts chapter 6, verse 7 tells us some of the priests became believers too. These events were just too impossible, really, to not believe. They had to be true because of the magnitude of these things that happen. Matthew, as well as the other Gospels, gives us multiple testimonies that Jesus is Lord and that He rose from the dead. Even nature, with its earthquakes and its darkness, testifies to Jesus being who He said He was, the Messiah, the Son of God. The angel testified to the women. The empty tomb stood as a silent witness to the resurrection. The women testified to the disciples, for they saw Jesus and spoke with Him. And the soldiers were witnesses too, as they told the chief priests. And later in Matthew 28, the 11 disciples, eventually they too saw Jesus. In a way, even the chief priests gave testimony to the resurrection, because they admitted that the tomb was empty. They had to come up with some kind of excuse why it was empty, but they at least knew that it was empty. They had no other explanation that was reasonable except that Jesus was risen. But then, even as now, some refused to believe. Jesus rising from the dead is to them an inconvenient truth. If He is alive, they'd have to change. They'd have to change the way they think and the way they live. They refuse to believe the Bible, even though it has proven itself trustworthy time and again. But do you know what the best witness is to Jesus' resurrection, aside, of course, from the Scriptures? It's your changed life. The life of a person who knows Jesus, who lives what Jesus taught. The person who has hope in a dreary world. The person who fears nothing, not even death, is a powerful, incontrovertible witness. Jesus taught us, love one another as I have loved you. By this will all people know you are my disciples, if you love one another. Paul says in Romans chapter 10, everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. If you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that God raised Him from the dead, you will be saved. If we live as though we believe this is true, we can turn the world upside down, just as the apostles did. Jesus is risen. Jesus is alive. We know it because we know Him. He's our Savior. He answers prayers. We experience His presence in our lives. Let us believe it and proclaim it and live it. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Let's pray. Lord, we believe in You, the Father who created us in all things, the Son who died to forgive us our sins and rose again to give us eternal life, the Holy Spirit who gives us new birth and a holy life through Your Word and through Your presence. We rejoice in the testimony from the Bible that You are risen and alive. We thank You for Your presence with us and in us, and that You promise always to be with us. We thank You for the gift of Holy Communion. You told us it is Your body and blood, given unto death for the forgiveness of our sins. And You also said, whoever eats My flesh and drinks My blood has eternal life. As we eat the bread and drink the wine this day, share with us Your glorious presence, the forgiveness of our sins, the grace to live in holiness and truth, and hope for eternal life. We pray for healing today, healing of spirit and soul and body of all those who look to You. We pray for wisdom for our leaders to guide our nation, our states, our communities in ways of righteousness and peace, according to Your word and according to good law. We pray for the boldness also for Your people and for us to speak Your word. For all these things and all other things that You see that we need, we also pray together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be Thy name. Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. If you have brought your